on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
Welcome to News Laundry Chhota Hafta. For the full episode, subscribe because it is behind the paywall and only subscribers get access to uncut, complete content. News Laundry Hafta is our weekly wrap of all that made the news, all that didn't, and all that should have, and all that shouldn't have. We agree, we disagree, we critique, and occasionally we beat each other up. But it's all good fun. Subscribe.
This is a News Laundry podcast, and you're listening to NL Hafta.
We are back with Hafta yet again, kyunki angrez apna lagan aur News Laundry apna hafta kabhi nahi chhodte. We have a panel that is fairly diverse, including someone joining us on the phone from Karnataka. But before I introduce our panel, I would just like to plug, when the public pays, the public is served. When advertisers pay, advertisers are served, as is proved by Cobrapost sting, which we will discuss in this podcast. So do subscribe and pay to keep news free. All of you who are listening to this podcast for free, you are getting the Chhota Hafta, which means you have been shortchanged. To get the full change and to be the change, you have to subscribe and pay for news because someone's got to pay. If it's not you, it's the advertiser, in which case it's not serving you. So today we're going to be discussing the following, the forthcoming Karnataka election, for which we have someone from Karnataka, because we get a lot of criticism that you Delhi mein baith ke tum south ka gyan pelte ho. So this time we have someone who can tell us gyan from on the ground. And his name is Prabhu Malikarjun. He's a journalist. He works as managing editor at 101 Reporters. And all news professionals listening to this, definitely use their services. It's a fantastic collection of reporters who do freelance stories, but they are a collective. He reports mainly on South politics. He's worked earlier with the New Indian Express and Financial Express, among others. Welcome, Prabhu.
Hi.
Also with us is our managing editor, Raman Kripal. Hi, Raman sir.
Hi.
We have Meghnad, a columnist and performer of Constitution.
Hi. Performer of Constitution. Thank you.
Manisha Pandey.
Hi.
Our in-house anchor, reporter and general spreader of wrappers that she throws around when she eats anything. And then she pelos gyan about Saaf India. Whatever.
I always throw my wrapper in the dustbin. I think you're talking about yourself, how you make interns and all your employees pick up wrappers behind you.
कैसे यार बताओ
That's
ऐसे मतलब ऐसे reporters
throws a banana peel at us उछालो लोग
banana I don't eat bananas because I'm diabetic तो आपकी चोरी पहले ही पकड़ी गई so and Madhu will be joining us shortly. We'll be discussing the following, the Karnataka election and possibly the poll date leak, what that means, the Cobrapost expose which has been mainly ignored by legacy media, Ram Navami, which has become a huge celebration all over the country in rather macabre ways. Then two killed in clashes during Ram Navami in Bengal. Bihar, curfew imposed during Ram Navami celebration. So it was a nice jolly Ram Navami all over the country. Yet another journalist killed, this time in a really sick way by running over by a truck. Video footage of that also emerged, this time in Madhya Pradesh. And these three journalists were run down by vehicles. There's an article in The Guardian on it. So Indian media makes its way to international news publications as well for not the right reasons. The data breach controversy, BJP blames Congress, Congress blames BJP, everybody blames, what's it called?
Cambridge
Analytics. And Cambridge says it has nothing to do with us as a university. Then BJP calls Rahul tech illiterate. The autonomy of universities, the UGC grants autonomy to 60 educational institutions. We will not discuss it in much detail in this podcast because you can listen to more gyan on that in our other podcast, Reporters Without Orders. So that won't be discussed here. And we will discuss the CBSE leak. And if we have the time, Anna Hazare's hunger strike for Lokpal at the Ram Leela Maidan. And if anyone wants to discuss cricket, you're most welcome. I'm not interested. So let's start with you. About Karnataka, Prabhu, as of now, who seems to have the upper hand? Not that I expect journalists to predict elections because it's not a very noble or accurate pursuit. But what are the issues going to be in the election? And the media coverage during election in UP we saw was very polarized. Are we expecting the same kind of media coverage there?
Well, interestingly, this time, particularly for the media coverage, if we talk about, we have seen chief ministers and ex-chief ministers visiting some of the media houses and then, you know, giving an hour talk and talking about their political parties and, you know, the future of 2018 and the next 5 years. So this is something which was not done before. I mean, earlier media used to go to political parties and get an interview. Now that political parties are coming to media offices, mainstream media offices are doing. So something, looking at a different level, kind of campaigning that we are looking at. And that said, see, it's going to be an important election for all the three political parties, the Congress, the BJP, and the regional party, JDS. Interestingly, Congress seems to have an upper hand because they seem to bank on the kind of stable government that Siddaramaiah has delivered. While BJP has got not much to campaign for, so they are bringing in national leaders and then again bringing in the aspect of the Modi flavor, what they are calling it as. And if I would like to divide the state into three different zones: the south region, the North Karnataka region, and the coastal region. So the battle seems to be interesting at three different aspects. In North Karnataka, the Congress has already challenged the BJP with the Lingayat vote ban by giving them a special status. And in terms of the coastal region, while BJP has an upper hand, they've been campaigning hard with respect to killing of some of the Karyakartas, and BJP has won many MP seats there. So they have an upper hand.
So, I mean, similar to the entire narrative in Kerala about the Karyakarta killing kind of thing. But one question I have for you, the Lingayat issue, how important or significant is it? And of what I have read, Yedurappa too had signed a petition asking for them to be declared a separate religion several years ago. Is no one is going to oppose it? Is that what we have to understand and why?
BJP has been... So now that BJP has been put on the back foot, what they are saying is, I am putting forward a Lingayat leader, that is Yedurappa. So, which is why, all Lingayats vote for BJP assets, that's what they claim. However, Congress has, diminished in terms of the Lingayat vote bank by just putting the ball in the center's court. Now, the center cannot take action because the moral code of conduct has come in place. So, Congress has won in terms of, okay, fine, I've given you the status, now it is at the center's end. So it seems like Congress has an upper hand here. It may not be much of an importance for JDS as such because they are banking on the Okaliga vote bank.
I see. Does anybody have anything to add on this? Just stay with us, Prabhu, on the Lingayat issue. Do any of you know how Lingayats are significantly different from other Hindus, or if there is any Shaivites and Vaishnavites? Why? What is the difference in Lingayats and other Hindus, Prabhu?
The Lingayats follow the Basavanna principles as such. So that's the only difference that comes into aspect. And even if you look at Congress, the Congress has been targeting the Lingayat vote bank for a long time. It's not just that it's come in the last 3-4 months. In the last 1 year, if you look at, they renamed some of the universities with Akramana Devi Women's University, and they are, Basavanna's photos has to be put in all government offices. So they've been quoting controversies in the last few months or years.
So basically, this is their way of kind of dividing the Hindu vote. But was the Hindu vote ever consolidated in Karnataka like you find it in, other parts of the country in the north?
No, the Hindu vote was not consolidated, but what you call as the Kannada acronym, Ahinda, for the minorities, backward classes, and the Dalits, this was consolidated during the 2013 elections. So the Siddaramaiah government came to power because of the Ahinda vote bank. Now that they are looking beyond Ahinda and then, going for Lingayat and
anyone?
So Congress has, yeah.
Sorry, anyone has an intervention or a question for Prabhu?
No, the BJP build-up after Amit Shah took over, say in the past 2 years, I mean, how is this happening? Can we quantify the BJP build-up in the past 2 years in Karnataka? In terms of cadre?
I would look at from two perspectives. One, at the grassroots level, how they are growing, and two, at the national level, how they are playing the politics. So if you look at for the BJP, considering that Yedurappa was involved in the mining scam, arrested and stuff, they don't have much to say about Yedurappa. So they are bringing in the good politics of Modi and Amit Shah. That's how they are suggesting for the state politics, which may or may not work, because the state would also look at some of the state leaders, how they are. That said, at the grassroots level, these guys are good. At every block level, they are arranging like 9 members, which includes a backward class member, a minority member, a Brahmin,
That's quite nice,
and
actually.
So, and these 9 will have to go to every house and then tell about BJP's agendas and what they have done in the last 5 years at the national level, and then that's their campaign move. So while there is not much of prominence that is seen in the media, but they are going at a grassroots level to a great extent.
But to be clear, that's how elections are won. That's what AAP did in Delhi.
No. Having said that, what are the issues?
See, issues, if you look at up north, it is more of not much of importance being given to the backward class and assets, and in terms of development and importance of the education sector, that's not being given in the northern sector. Down south, it is more of the urban vote which they are targeting, again, the infrastructure development, and perhaps even killing of Gauri Lankesh would play certain roles in the how it is going to emerge in the Mysore and the Bangalore vote bank. And towards the coastal region, development may not play a card, but it is more of the Hindutva consolidation of votes will play much of a role.
Interesting.
Okay, thanks so much for joining us, Prabhu. I hope you have an enjoyable coverage of the election and your reports find themselves into every self-respecting newsroom. Thank you.
Thank you.
Raman sir, why don't you start? What issue is you think of significance that happened last week?
Something which hasn't been covered much, I think, Cobrapost.
Right. Cobrapost. Yeah. So tell me, we've discussed it with Amit on the other podcast. So those of you who want to hear a first-hand account, you can listen to Reporters Without Orders. That's a free podcast, you Mufatkhur cheapsters. So you can listen to it for free. But why do you think, and also not just has it not been covered, a lot of very prominent journalists didn't even tweet out that story or even question it. Some have. Is it an aversion to sting operations? Is it because they think that next? Because he has said there'll be part two coming up in 2 weeks.
Maybe it's because everybody is doing it now. So
no, it has. It obviously had to deal with the media. So basically, there is an unwritten rule that one media house will not touch the another. So unlike us, unlike News London. So you won't see, the other newspapers like Times of India will not be reporting much about Hindustan Times.
But Hindu covered it.
Hindu and Indian Express.
So very few, and very, very rudimentary.
I don't think the Hindu report named
nobody
any channel.
Nobody tried to cross-check. Nobody tried to do, take the story further. So normally we journalists take the story forward, But having said that, I personally am,
not a sting operation fan.
I though hate sting. So for that matter, I don't. I think that sting,
is lazy investigation.
It is, in a way. See, if you are doing some investigations, which is document-based and all, and there you need to do some sting.
That's part of a larger
larger cons. Then it is fine. But otherwise,
just video evidence is nothing.
See, what has happened in this particular case. What was the expose? Expose was, there's one undercover reporter. He was doing most of the talking. He was trying to sell the Hindutva agenda. And he is not even going to the editorial staff. He's going to the mostly to the sales people. Okay. I have worked for 30 years. In a place like Indian Express, sales though, they don't matter. They never come to us. In a place like DNA also, the sales guy will just come and they used to say, ki, sir, ye carry kar lijiye.
Ho sakta hai, toh karo
kar lijiye, haan. Nobody will come to us and say ki Hindutva ka agenda aapko front page mein lagana hai. I have never seen like this. So they have picked up the vulnerable people. In the sales, and if you're offering somebody that if you run this agenda and I'm going to get you 1 crore rupees, and that's what matters to the salespeople in the newspaper.
But why didn't they come to us? We could use some money.
So I find it very, I think they just went, I didn't find much, in this sting operation.
Manisha?
So yeah, I'm also conflicted on sting. I'm not a big fan because I think it can take a story to only a certain place, and if you don't investigate further, you just left at the surface or the trend of what's happening. But I think this thing, I'll get to the media coverage. We have today a media that reports on WhatsApp messages, unauthenticated WhatsApp messages, find their way into TV news, find their way into primetime debates, find their way even on front page. So this is not about authenticity. This is purely because media name, there are media, big media houses named in it, and there's a part two, which may name the rest. So I think it's just about not touching it because you can be caught as well in it. And I'd say that even a coverage does not mean that take Cobrapost's videos at face value. You could very well question it. You could talk about the trends that come out of it. But the complete silence is bizarre. Except for Indian Express and Hindu, no one even touched it is, to me, really bizarre.
Inconsistent with
not
the behavior.
Surprising in a way. And I think just the sting operation bit, I've seen the Scoop one very clearly. I've seen the Dainik Jagran one very clearly. And I've seen one more TV channel, I forget the name. There's even proof. This guy poses as an acharya. He says, I want three things done. First, peddle soft Hindutva, then target opposition leaders, and then glorify Hindu leaders like Yogi. The very next day after this conversation, you see on a TV channel targeting the same guys that these guys have a conversation about targeting. You know, Modi ke saath dushman. Dainik Jagran has said he didn't have any authority to make the claims he did. But he is completely unabashedly talking about, and this is not just a random sales guy, he's a guy who's in charge of three regions. And he's saying, you know, that hamara to identity hi Hindutva hai. Agar kisi ke saath so ke bhi data nikalna hai, to hum nikalwa denge. Or Mamata Banerjee,
West Bengal. What he's saying is that men and women who will go.
And he's saying that Mamata Banerjee ki against, we'll do targeted investigations against her, which is then again, you know, you and I, it's an editorial director that's meeting. So I think it's a very big sting. You don't have to report it in a way to just say, wow, what a great sting and lovely and everything is fine. But to at least raise it up and look at what's happening in the media. I mean, to have such like thin line between sales, editorial, ads, news, it was very...
And we have here Madhu. Hi, Madhu. You missed Prabhu. Oh, that doesn't rhyme. I thought it rhymed. In my head, it rhymed. Madhu, Prabhu.
Madhu and Prabhu. Prabhu Chawla?
No. Prabhu. No. Prabhu from 101 reports from Karnataka to give us the view from Karnataka. Okay. Young, able.
Oh, I missed that. I would have liked to hear it, but so, I'll hear it on the.
But on this, Madhu, I know what your view is, but let's tell everybody else also on this thing.
Well, I think it's notable that Manisha has mentioned Hindu and Indian Express. Because as far as I know, these are two papers that do not do paid editorials and impact features and this thing. So it is noticed, and she's mentioned it for good reason. Secondly, I think as far as stings go, I think there are some stories that can only be done as a sting. Because when things are done, say, for example, that the Helka Operation West End, you cannot ever catch army officers taking money in a straight story.
Right.
It has to be done in a sting. And if it's in public interest, I'm all for it. But it has gone haywire, as you saw after the Tehelka thing. There was a series of stings where everybody was doing it on each other. Politicians were doing it on each other. And it went a little crazy. So I think it has to be very carefully monitored. For example, the Daily News sat on a sting operation for a year and a half, in which they did a sting on real estate, on how blacks are turned away from certain areas and certain neighborhoods. And even then, the editor was not satisfied. He said he may have turned them away for other reasons. So they really sat on it until they could get the proof with the sting operations for a year and a half. That's a long time for a story to sit. So that's one thing. Secondly, I think that what Cobrapost showed was shown much better, more intensively and extensively in a film that we had put on News Laundry for a long time called Brokering News, in which they had done sting operations as well as open interviews, which showed that newspapers, especially pre-election, during the election campaign time, they go with packages to, especially regional papers, they go with packages to politicians, right, and then say, if you pay more, we'll do negative stories about your opponent.
Also,
yeah.
So
all that has been done before. So I think I was not very surprised or excited about this Scoop thing. It's been done far more journalistically and deeply in that film, Brokering News. The other thing is that it's not a secret that large news organizations, particularly the one who invented it, they have PowerPoint presentations on, they'll go to, in fact, hospitals, they'll go to corporates, they'll say, we will do a package for you in which we'll do editorial. And, you know, so many times you'll see a full page on how dysentery, bacteria, diarrhea is destroying villages and rural health. And then you turn the page and there's a thing for Dettol. And that's not an accident. Or it's even on the facing page.
Right.
So Dettol kills all germs and do this and do that. I mean, it's happened invariably. It just doesn't require high intelligence to figure it out. Any average reader will see that this whole page has dragged it, and then on the other page, use Dettol, all the germs will go. Oh, please.
I just have
itne buddhu nahi hai log.
This mail is from Sandeep. Hi, Newsline team. I have been a subscriber of NL for a while now and intend to remain so. I strongly believe subscription is the only model that can keep the semblance of independent media intact, and hence do my bit to convince my friends here in the US to get an NL subscription. Thank you, Sandeep. Really appreciate that. Abhinandan's weekly jab at Mufat Khors does work, and I hope he continues doing that. Yes, Mufat Khors, are you listening? Have some shame. Pay to keep news free. You must see buying undies for 250 rupees, a cigarette packet for 300 rupees, Khandani Shafa Khana pills for 1,000 rupees, and other such things. You know, but the one thing that you need to keep up is the sanctity of news. Other things, even if they don't remain up, it'll chalega. But zindagi kaise chalegi bina news ke? So please subscribe. Newsline does a great job in providing a platform for all kinds of ideologies and opinions. However, I do feel views expressed by some of the Hafta panelists at times get predictable and appear to be get colored by the respective ideologies. Isn't that inevitable, Sandeep? We all have our ideological biases and preference, and I think the mainstream media does more than better job to reinforce these prejudices. I feel Newsline is different, and a bit more objectivity would help the listeners get a nuanced perspective. Well, we shall try, but I don't think we give binary opinions, but yeah. And finally, a shout out to Abhinandan. You are a rock star. Thank you, Sandeep.
What
you
a smile, my God.
You should have been here. It sounds like he's believing it.
Achha, Sandeep, dekho mera mazaak uda raha.
Sun liya Afrika, mufat khoro. Not to brag or anything, but News Laundry Hafta features in the top 50 in the world on SoundCloud in the news and politics category for podcasts. So do subscribe and see what you're missing, because when the public pays, the public is served. When advertisers pay, advertisers are served. Subscribe, help keep news independent and free.
All News Laundry podcasts are available on iTunes and Stitcher and any other podcast platform.